asked again, Geb. This is the friend of the Exarch I was telling you about.
Very good, very good. Though friend or no, all are welcome in Mordsuk.
Suk is Mordish for city. As things stand, this Suk boasts the largest and busiest marketplace in all Armorang. You'll find ore from the mines here, of course, but all manner of other things, too. Many of them rare. As I told you before, not many visit Armorang by choice, but Mordsuk's a different story. Merchants come from realms around to purchase the relics the Mord dig up.
Aye, that they do, for Mords do not dismiss the spoils of the earth. We clean them and polish them and reveal to the world their true value. That is why they come here, come from far away, come with much money. And so our Suk is always busy, busy, busy. No such thing as a thing no one needs.
You say that every time, Master Gengen. Some sort of family motto, wasn't it? Or perhaps a Mord philosophy, for which we should all be very grateful. Would that everyone was so willing to take in refugees, regardless of race or creed. Now then. If you intend to spend any time here, you'll want to gain the trust of the locals. And there's a little custom all newcomers are expected to observe.
The cracking of the coin purse. You buy one thing from the market. Price can be low or high, just as long as you buy.
As the good Mord says. In fact, the Exarch sent a little something to cover this very expense. A Verbert gold piece, no less. The first I've held in years.
Verbert gold? Real Verbert gold?
Here, newcomer, crack your coin purse with me.
Oh no, you want Michael to newcomer. I have jars and pots all smooth and shiny.
Over here!
Come and look!
You buy, you buy.
Enough of that! Calm, I say! This one must still journey through the barrens. Nothing bulky, nothing heavy, no pots! Nothing better for the road than a full belly. Spend that piece at Ronron's place, yes? Eat the three before you leave.
Thank you. Just a lesser sin eater. Nothing to write home about. I knew you'd turn up sooner or later, but I had been hoping for sooner. How are you? We've fought them to a standstill then. The Exarch did say that the Empire seemed to have drawn back when he last looked in on the source. But without knowing for sure how fast time was passing there, I couldn't help worrying that a lot might have happened since then. I'm heartily relieved to hear that it hasn't, just as Alphano must have been. As you can imagine, both he and Urianger were desperate to hear the news from home when I arrived. I haven't actually seen Thancred and Yshtola yet, but they will have heard all the latest developments from the Exarch by now, or should have at least. When I think of how frantic Tataru and the others must be, I want nothing more than to rush back and reassure them. But we still haven't found a way to reverse the summoning, and even if we had, we couldn't just ignore Urielje's vision. He may use 10 words where one would suffice, and they may often obscure as much as they reveal. But on this matter, he was as clear as day. I do not doubt for one moment that he saw what he claims. Nor how difficult it must have been to speak about them. The 8th Umbral Calamity and your death aren't exactly topics for idle conversation. As much as I might want to go home, I don't want to go home to that. We can't allow the rejoining to happen, which means we have to save the first from the Sin Eaters. That great wall of white is a remnant of the Flood. 100 years ago, the balance in the First tipped decisively in favor of light. From that moment, it rose and swelled with each passing day, and then, without warning, it burst forth like water from a broken dam. A colossal wave of pure light, drowning everything in its wake. Only Norvrant was spared. For the most part, living things are composed of ether of various different aspects. But when exposed to such a flood, their etheric harmony is shattered, and their natural form breaks down. Then they either perish, or are warped into mindless abominations. Yes, that's how the Sin Eaters came to be. They were once living creatures, or people, that were caught in the path of the Flood. Once the change is wrought, there is no going back. In that instant, they are gripped by an insatiable appetite for ether, and will happily gorge themselves on any living thing within reach. But even that is not the worst of it. The stronger Sin Eaters can plant light in us, like seeds in soil, corrupting our ether, and triggering the birth of new monstrosities. They are creatures of base instinct, that exist only to feed and to multiply. They feel no pity. Know no remorse and are utterly deaf to reason. Which is why they must be destroyed. Every last one of them. The infirmary is full of the Sin Eaters' victims, left here to spend their final hours waiting for the change to overtake them. Look, over there, where the wall is broken. Do you see what lies beyond? That's what the land became after the light flooded in. An empty, white nothingness. Life cannot exist in such conditions. The primordial light would wreak havoc on the body's etheric balance. That nectarine you bought. It's Halric's favorite fruit. Most of the patients, Halric included, survived the attacks of powerful eaters. But their fate was sealed all the same. The monster's corruption has entered their bodies, and their very essence is being subsumed by light. The twisted state of the world itself just makes matters worse. Under normal circumstances, a person's ether naturally tends to equilibrium. But for these poor souls, the opposite is true. Sooner or later, every single one of them will turn. Tesline and the patients, they all know this. They know what has to be done before the change goes too far, before the eater within takes over. The preferred method is mixing poison into their favorite food. In my time here, I've borne witness to a lot of last meals. I feel just as helpless as before. No matter how hard I fight, it's never enough. But it's a war I mean to wage, nonetheless. Speaking of wars, do you remember how I made you promise not to leave me and then promptly collapsed? Well, let's just say I had a few choice words for the Exarch concerning the timing of his summons. But even if the fault lay with someone else, I couldn't shake the feeling that I'd abandon you on the battlefield. So I swore that I'd make up for my absence there by making a difference here. And that's what keeps me moving forward, even when things seem hopeless. On which note, it's time we headed back. The longer we keep Tesline waiting, the harder this will be for her.